put in relation to our Living History Project, you can see here yourself, you see all the absolutely beautiful wagons. And wagons are beautiful symbols and they are decorated to the extreme. And but wagons were not always there, they're actually fairly new with travellers. Wagons didn't come in until literally around after the First World War when travellers started to use wagons. Before that they would have used the tents that we have up here in front. But the wagons were so important to them because what it literally done for them is that they could move around winter and summer then. They had something which was more solid, more permanent for them. But they took great care. The wagon you see here was known as a lorry wagon. And as you can see, the four wheels are the same size. But there was another wagon, which was an older wagon, which had a very large wheel at the back and a small wheel in front, and they were called common wagons. And if you're seeing a travelling family with a lorry wagon and a tent, we're talking about well-to-do people. They weren't poor people at this stage, because to have a wagon was quite expensive. But travellers themselves came highly skilled in actually making these wagons. And today, even places like this, you can see people coming to bring the beautiful wagons with them. And it's their way of expressing, look at my skills, look at what I can do, and it's absolutely gorgeous. So, wagons in that role. The wagons are painted, which we call striping, right? Now, I actually don't know what all the symbols mean. But some of the symbols on it still mean, like, you can see in the bottom of there, it has one that represents water. And that symbol actually means the people who lived in these wagons were actually extremely superstitious people. And that symbol was there because everybody knows that a witch, or worse still, a banshee, can't cross water. And that's why the symbols were at the doorway, and if you look at the back, you see them underneath the windows as well, at the very back of it. And that stopped it again. We call that Pishro, which is all what he says, but nevertheless, that's what the symbols had meanings, and the colours were very important. And that's why you have a very gay colour, and actually painted in such a manner, like, you know? So very good. The wagons themselves, this one here is called a Newry model, as in the town of Newry, where travellers used to go and get these type made. But other wagons we met in. So you had a Newry wagon, it was like the Mercedes-Benz of the wagons, you know, so it was well up there with the rest of them, you know. So in relation, I'm talking about wagons and wheels, but they are played an important role. And it allowed travellers to move on. And as you can see, the shape of them, and that was... Like in England, if you went to England and you were looking at the gypsy wagons, you would see them very square wooden wagons. Here, because of maybe the terrain and the landscape, the round wagon would seem to be much, much better. And at the front of it is done with doors and done with timber, and a Welsh one would be the same as this, but it would have no front, it would have a canvas front. And they were called open knot wagons. So I don't know what else to tell you, there's tons of stuff about wagons. But I just think they played a huge, important role. And as you've seen yourself, it was a bit like Doctor Who's box there, the amount of children coming out. They actually held a lot. And full families were actually rare, didn't they? And not only were full families rare than these wagons here, but these, you get them different sizes. Yeah, small wagon, large wagon, family-sized wagons, and that's the way it was. The wagon itself, actually, and it looks as if it's for a summertime, but they actually have fire inside of a stove inside them. And the wee stove was known as a queen stove, a little queenie stove. And that stove actually was used to heat the wagon. And even in the depths of winter, when you had that fire lit, you had to open them doors, it was like a sauna. So they're actually insulated and they're actually extremely warm. So people might think they were cold, they're actually well, you know?
Is that it finished?
Thank you. just the kind of appetite in terms of, you know, they sell them drugs.
There's some videos that came inside and shared off the
local. Yeah. There is a guy in Craig Nanana who does this. It's hard to get.
Tom, what do you think Tom is doing? You sure? And what's he making a cup out of? It's called tin. What's it called?
Tin.
So it's a tin cup, isn't it? No, and did you ever hear the word tin smith?
Yeah.
So what's a tin smith? Did you ever hear the word a blacksmith? Or a whitesmith? They were both professions, so Tom was known as a tinsmith because he made things out of tin. And what he's doing there is making, I don't know what you call them here,
pannikins.
What would you call that?
No,
what do you call the type of, we call them mush-up or pannikin or saucepan.
Tin mug.
Yeah. There's no name, local name.
I'm sure there's a name in it.
There probably is.
Yeah, get the historian out. Where is she? That's the historian. Find out the name for that.
Yeah.
Well, we call them pannikins or saucepans, or in traveller's language, we call it gush-up.
A what?
A gush-up.
Was the traveller's name for it.
Yeah.
And the thing he's used, and that piece of a steak is probably the most important thing he had. And that was called a scutcher.
Yeah.
A scutcher. That was the most important one he had. The hominages, that's called a canon, isn't it? A canon. And then he had two different clips. You know when he's cutting them? He's one for cutting, but he had another one which was called a lagging clip, and that was for bending it. He wasn't actually cutting, he's making lips on it. And then he joins them together and folds it, and that makes it work. It's a profession trade that's dying at its best.
Yeah.
Very little tinsmiths left in the country.
That's
a few far between. And Tom learned that in university, didn't you, Tom?
Yeah.
In university went to, what was it? UCD, you learned that. Tom learned that, and if you notice, Tom's knuckles are very sore. And that was how you were taught. Every time you got it wrong, you got a slap in the knuckles out of that scotch. And his daddy was very nice. Wonderful.
Very, very, very.
And that's how you actually learn the children. At this age, here, you know, they will be given little jobs. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And that's the university behind them.
He makes his mixture of a jet. Now, you've seen there, he's making an edge on it. He's not actually cutting it. And that's called a lagging.
A lagging jacket.
I know we never brought a Now, the travellers years ago, what would you call that? We called it a saucepan or a gusher or a pannikin. Good man, there you are.
Well,
that's
the
local name, right. A ponder.
A ponder
is right. That's the local name. No, you don't move in, no move back. Because you know what happened, no move back. Because little bits of tin might come up and would cut in your leg, move back. And you would have a cut leg that would roll. Very sad. Let's make whistles. And then at dinner time, Give him a big round of applause. Yeah. Thanks for that memory, because you're not going to see that for a long while. Quite sad.